So it's a pleasure to introduce our second keynote speaker, Eric Shoebridge. I'm not going to spend a lot of time going over all of his credentials and awards and achievements that he's done, but all of us know for the last several decades, Eric's lab has made seminal discoveries on mitochondrial biology, and every year or so, he's always giving a new talk, presenting a new area of mitochondrial biology that is always enlightening and is always provocative. And I'm sure that that's going to be the case today when he tells us about some of the RNA granules that he's discovered in mitochondria. We also chose Eric as one of our keynote speakers because he's also a fantastic mentor. There are several people in the audience which Eric was the mentor for, so Anu and Heidi and Brandon Battersby, for example, all trained with Eric and are making great contributions to the field. And the other thing is that Eric's just a really cool guy. So that's the other reason why we invited him to be the keynote speaker, because he's just really cool. So I'd like to thank Eric for coming and start the session off. Thank you.
Thanks. Am I on? Do I use this computer here? No, this is somebody else's computer. I don't see any other controls here. Maybe this is it? The black one? Okay. Is this turned on? Somebody has to turn it on for me. So maybe I'm going to present some of the work from the last of our several decades of work in Montreal from when I was a young lad. And I moved from NMR to doing genetics. That works? Still doesn't work. That work? That works. I guess I should wear a tie or something. Eh? How's that? So thanks, Paolo Andy Jardon, for inviting me to give the kickoff the second day. Never been to China before. It's my first visit. And usually when I go someplace, I like to rent a bike. And I came a day early, so I rented a bike from the hotel. And what I can say is I lived to be here this afternoon, this morning, actually. It's pretty hair-raising. I rode into the old city, and what I realized pretty early on is there are no rules. It's just total Darwinian. This will go. Okay, so we've spent not quite several decades, but about two of them, studying mitochondrial diseases in my lab. And at the time we started, they were thought to be extraordinarily rare disorders, mostly because they have these wide variety of phenotypes, and people who had the diseases would see, a few patients, but nobody put the whole thing together. And a few groups have now done some epidemiological studies, and it's pretty clear that the birth incidence, I'll get the pointer maybe here, yeah, is about 1 in 5,000. So they're amongst the most common metabolic disorders. And as you probably appreciate, they come in two flavors. Some of them are Mendelian, most of the Mendelians are recessive, and Anu gave a really, really nice talk on one that's dominant, one recessive last night. They tend to be severe early onset disorders, although as Anu pointed out, there's a lot of variability there. The mitochondrial DNA ones that are maternally inherited tend to be less severe with later onset, and this slide's about 80% true because about 20% of these disorders actually have their origins in mitochondrial DNA. So people have worked on the mitochondrial genome since the late 1980s when the first mutations were found, and mutations have now been found in every gene, I think, multiple mutations in every gene in the genome. The vast majority of them, however, are associated with tRNAs, even though that makes up about 10% of the genome. Most of the mutations in the adult population, at least, are tRNA point mutations. And there's a reason for that, which I don't have time to talk about, but it involves the transmission of DNA through the female germline. Nobody's been able to figure out why there's such a huge spectrum of clinical variability associated with these disorders and why there's so much tissue specificity, and that's probably because nobody's been smart enough to figure out how to transform mammalian mitochondrial DNA to order. So people have isolated things and made mice the hard way. It took them about 10 years to do it, but you can't go in and make, say, a point mutation in the tRNA that specifies lysine to mimic the human one and ask you get a mouse model that looks like the human disease, like you can with the nuclear encoded mutations. So the genome is really compact, small, and regulation of this is almost entirely post-transcriptional. So the transcription of the human genome, of the mitochondrial genome, is rather boring. It's three transcription units, polycistronic transcription units, reflecting the bacterial origins of the mitochondrial genome. And most of the regulation of expression of what's in the genome, the 13 proteins that are there, happens after things are transcribed. And that's where I want to focus my attention. So as I mentioned, the transcripts are polycistronic. They get processed by RNase P at the 5' end of tRNAs and RNase Z at the 3' end. It's also called ELAC2. And this was the kind of tRNA punctuation model first proposed by the late Giuseppe Attardi when the genome was first cloned in the 1980s. They're not capped like messages in the cytosol, and they essentially have no 5' UTRs, no significant 5' UTRs. So we don't know how they recognize the ribosomes, the mitochondrial ribosomes, to initiate translation. That's a total black box. And we don't have an in vitro system to study it. Lots of people have tried. I don't know how many lots is, but some people have tried, and they're no longer in science, I don't think, because they're not talking about it. So it's a difficult problem, and I think the community should probably come together and try and solve that. But getting the community together is maybe a little bit like herding cats sometimes. They all have poly-A tails, which are rather short, except one of them doesn't, the message for ND6. There's no poly-A binding protein to protect the poly-A tails, so there's some other things that do that I don't have time to talk about. And two of them are bicistronic, and we don't know how that works. How do they have overlapping reading frames, and we don't know how they get translated. So the translation happens on a system that resembles a prokaryotic system. Even though the RNA polymerase that produces the transcripts is phage-like, everything else is bacterial-like. So mitochondrial ribosomes have antibiotic sensitivities that are very similar to bacterial ribosomes, but they're totally different in terms of the protein-RNA ratio. And in fact, mitochondrial ribosomes that are evolving at this incredible rate, and nobody understands why. And nowadays, with cryo-EM structures, people like Vicky Ramakrishnan at Cambridge is determining the structure of mitochondrial ribosomes from a variety of organisms and finds pretty serious differences between them. And in the mammalian system, about 40% of the structural subunits have absolutely no bacterial orthologs you can recognize. So they came from somewhere else, like somewhere else, but where's the somewhere else? And Vicky was actually at Montreal last week and I said, do you have any idea where these things came from? And he said, no. So that's the answer to that question, nobody knows. And nobody knows why they're evolving so rapidly, I mean, compared to cytosolic ribosomes or bacterial ribosomes. You need to produce only proteins that are highly hydrophobic, polytopic membrane proteins that are probably co-translationally inserted into the membrane, but that really doesn't explain the difference between, say, yeast mitochondrial ribosomes in human, because they have the same problem, so we don't really know what happens there. So we, early on, decided to try to figure out some of the components of the translation system, of the post-transcriptional system, and we always started with human diseases. So early on, we figured out a way to clone disease genes from single cell lines that had a biochemical phenotype. That was called microcell-mediated chromosome transfer. And we started on one of the most common syndromes in the pediatric population called Lee syndrome, after Dennis Lee, who described the first case in the year I was born, several decades ago. And it has these particular characteristics. And we've worked on patients from a variety of clinical collaborators around the world who sometimes have patients who have Lee syndrome with optic atrophy, Lee syndrome with something else. But often, the fundamental, the presenting characteristic is this syndrome described by Dennis Lee in the 1950s. There's a French-Canadian form of this disease that has different tissue specificity that affects the brain and the liver, kind of similar to what Anu had described yesterday for one of the diseases she talked about. So we thought that the way to tackle this, to find the new biology, to find genes that might be associated with either the post-transcriptional, any part of the post-transcriptional apparatus or the translational apparatus, would be to do careful biochemical characterization of the cell lines and then do some kind of functional complementation cloning to figure out what was wrong. I mean, nowadays we just do whole exome sequencing, so my kids can do it. They may not be able to do the bioinformatics, but they can send the DNA to the center that does that stuff for them. But in the old days, it was kind of tricky. So we used two techniques to characterize the biochemistry. One is called blue native gel electrophoresis, which essentially just gives you a fingerprint of what the defect is. So these are native complexes in the respiratory chain, all five of them. And you can just run them on a native gel, and we have antibodies against the native complexes. And then you just read out what the defect is. So quite clearly what the defect here is, it's almost everything. Usually we use complex 2 as a loading control here because it's actually rarely affected in human disease. There are some examples. So there's clearly no complex 4 here. This is a subcomplex of 5. There's no complex 1. So there's a multiple respiratory chain deficiency in this patient who had Lee syndrome and optic atrophy. And if you do a mitochondrial translation experiment, which is also easy to do because you just label cells with 35S methionine, inhibit cytosolic translation, and you can look at the pattern on a 1D gel, a 1D denaturing gel, and it's pretty clear that this patient had a pretty severe defect in translation as well. So Hannah Antonishka took this on as a project a few years ago, and using this dinosaur technique of chromosome transfer, managed to clone, to identify the gene that was defective here, and it was turned out to be an open reading frame about which we knew nothing, C12ORF65. And we had two patients who both had essentially frame shifts, so they were null for the protein. What does this protein do? Well, we didn't really have any idea, but it's a member of a family of so-called peptide release factors. There are 4 of them in human mitochondria, and the group at Newcastle had figured out that only one of them, this particular one here, and what I'm showing is the structure of the 4 human factors that are known. Here's C12ORF65, overlaid on an authentic peptide release factor from E. coli. So you can see that this one matches very well, and what Zasha at Newcastle had produced a very nice paper showing that you really only needed this one for translation termination. So it wasn't clear what the other 3 did. And C12ORF65, you can see some of the helices map pretty well onto this, but there's a lot of stuff that's not there. So we had really no idea what it did. Probably was involved in something to do with the ribosome, and I'll show you that if I have time near the end of the talk. But all of these factors have 2 motifs which are highly conserved in these release factor proteins. This GGQ motif, which is important to the active site, and a tripeptide that recognizes the termination codon when it's in the A site. So what we did, what Hannah did, was immunoprecipitate this, looking for interacting partners. And I have to say, almost all the IPs that I'll present, some of them are all just native proteins. We very, very rarely overexpress something with a tag and IP it because we think we just get a lot of junk as sometimes when we do that. And what we found was a protein called GRSF1, which stands for G-rich sequencing factor, that co-IP'd. It was one of the top hits. And this protein had been known for a long time, since 1994. And a group led by this gentleman here had looked at it in the context of cells that were infected with influenza virus and showed in those experiments that it selectively bound the nucleocapsid protein of influenza virus and got it translated preferentially in the cell. And it turns out that probably most of that was just artifact from overexpression, because it probably has absolutely nothing to do with that, which we found out later, but I won't go into those details. So this looks like a classical RNA binding protein. This is the picture from his original paper. Has 3 RNA recognition domains, and actually I'll show you in a second, they're not quite canonical RNA recognition domains, and it has an unstructured N-terminus. And he said in the paper that it was cytoplasmic, and it very clearly was cytoplasmic, but beyond cytoplasmic, it was very clearly mitochondrial, because that's the picture in the original paper. So that got us a little bit away from the function of C12ORF65. We thought, this is pretty cool. What's this RNA binding protein doing in mitochondria? So Hannah Antonishka, and almost all of the work I'm going to present is hers today, started working this and showed it was a soluble protein. It behaved as a monomer, and it was in the mitochondrial matrix. And it's a member of a family of heteronuclear RNPs, the FH2 family, that have been worked on actually quite a bit. And the structure of these things in bound to RNA species has been determined in solution by NMR. I'll show you that in a second. And there are basically 3 of these RRM domains, and actually they're called quasi-RRM domains because they're not exactly canonical RNA recognition domains. There's a few amino acids that are different. But if you line up GRSF1 with the 2 members of this HNRNP family, you find out that, or you can see, that there's really extremely high conservation in these QRM domains. And the only real difference between GRSF1 and these guys is the N-terminus, which is extremely unstructured in GRSF1. And they don't have the same sequence in these other HNRP proteins. And that may be important for what I'm going to tell you in a minute, although we don't know that for sure. So a group in Zurich actually had been working on these, and they determined the NMR solution structure of one of them, of the HNRPF family, just the QRM domain in association with a G-rich sequence. So these, as I said, are it's called G-rich sequencing factor, so it binds RNA species that are extremely rich in Gs. And you may know that RNA species that are extremely rich in Gs have a tendency to form what are called G-quadruplexes. And these play important roles in biology, and I don't have time to go into the ones that are known. But essentially, once you form this structure, it's difficult to resolve it. And so what they showed was that this QRM domain actually had was very, very different in structure to the conventional RM domains, in that it formed these kind of fingers which interdigitated into this G-rich sequence and prevented it from forming a G-quadruplex, so kept it linear. And that's its function, we presume. The normal QRM domains, the normal ones, I mean, the conventional ones actually have a beta sheet structure here, and the RNA binds to that beta sheet structure. So these are really very, very different than the conventional RM domains. And we were going to determine the structure of this, but because the sequence conservation is so high, we showed that we could bind this substrate with the QRM domain from GRSF1, shift it on an EMSA assay, but it almost certainly is doing the same thing because the sequence is so conserved between the QRM domains and these proteins. So then we decided to have a look at it in mitochondria, and that's when things got sort of a little more interesting. What we found, we actually got a good antibody for this, and I can't remember whether this one we made or this one we bought. I was just talking to Andy. I mean, most of the ones we buy are garbage, 50%, so we throw them in the garbage. Sometimes we can get our money back, sometimes not from the company. But this one worked very well, and what it showed was this punctate structure very clearly, and these are 143B cells. They're osteosarcoma cells, and this is where we saw it most dramatically. These structures did not line up with nucleoids as visualized by an anti-DNA antibody, but they did co-localize, not quite perfectly, but more than 80% of them, with newly synthesized RNA as detected by pulse labeling with BRU. So here's a line scan here, and you can see there's a perfect correspondence between the GRSF1 puncta in these cells and newly synthesized RNA. So this is a really short pulse with BRU, less than a half hour. So newly synthesized polycistronic transcripts made in the nucleoid, because that's where they have to be made, seem to be immediately transferred to these structures that contain this RNA binding protein, GRSF1. What does it bind? Well, it's called G-rich sequence factor. It should bind G-rich transcripts. And in the mitochondrial genome, there are two strands called heavy and light. And the light strand produces G-rich transcripts. And it produces, especially the most G-rich one is ND6, the subunit that is not polyadenylated, the message is not polyadenylated, sorry. It's a 35% G. That's like way more than anything else in the mitochondrial genome. So what Hanna did was IP GRSF1, and then using quantitative RT-PCR strand specific, looked at what structures got bound, what RNA species got bound, and she found three that were highly enriched, the ND6 message, and two long non-coding RNAs which are immediately adjacent to the message, one for ND5 and one for cytochrome B. At the same time we were doing this, a group, Jean-Claude Martineau's group, and were also working on this, and thought that GRSF1 was probably important in processing the polycistronic transcripts, but we didn't find the same thing. So we looked at junctions between transcripts across the mitochondrial genome, and for instance, these are three different siRNAs for GRSF1 here in different colors, and if you just look at this one, the junction between cytochrome oxidase 1 and 2 subunit in the genome, and compare it to the processing defect you get when you knock out the RNase P that actually processes that, there's a huge difference between them. So you get 100-fold increases when you knock out the MRP, and you basically get nothing when you knock out GRSF1. So it didn't look to us like it was important in processing the polycistronic transcripts. Then we did one of these blue native gels. We generated a series of knockdowns of GRSF1 using siRNAs, and you can see here, this one didn't do very much, knocked it down to about 80%, and then this one knocked it down to almost nothing, so we had a very nice series. And if you run a blue native gel, you find out that you pretty much wipe out assembly of the respiratory chain when you do this. So what's going on? Well, there's a translation defect that is global, except that three species, and two especially, cytochrome B and ND6, are really affected in the translation gel, and ND5 as well, which, if you remember, ND5, cytochrome B, ND6 are those three things in the mitochondrial genome that are bound by GRSF1, but one of them is long non-coding, so that we don't really know how to connect those dots just yet. But it was clearly a non-random selective translation defect that we saw. We then did some Western blots and looked at steady state levels of ribosomal subunits and saw that mostly that they were decreased in the siRNA that produced the strongest knockdown here as well. So there's what's left of GRSF1, and there's a few of the fairly random collection of subunits, all in the large ribosomal subunit, which seems to be affected more in the small, at least in terms of steady state levels. And then Hannah looked at where RNAs were on a sucrose gradient attached to either the individual ribosome subunits or the monosome. And what she found, and I won't go into all the data because this is all published stuff, was that there was misloading of different RNAs onto individual subunits, and there was a problem with the small subunit, it seemed, because we got two peaks for this on a sucrose gradient. So it looked to us like there were problems with biosynthesis of the ribosomes if you didn't have GRSF1, and there were problems of putting RNAs, either long non-coding or messenger RNAs, on individual subunits, which we don't really know what that means. But in a control situation, either the RNAs run at the top of the gradient, so they're not being translated, or they run with the monosome. So there was some abnormality in ribosome biogenesis and in loading RNAs. So just to summarize that, we got specific translation defects associated with knockdown of GRSF1, combined defects in the respiratory chain assembly, problems with ribosome assembly and RNA loading onto the subunits. And because of the high conservation with the other members of this HNRNP family, the FH family, that probably implicates that the prevention of this G quadruplex formation is somehow important in the regulation of ribosome biogenesis or in the translation of some of the messages on the ribosome. Of course, it could be the GRSF1, the loss of GRSF1 in these granules affects other things that we don't know about in the granules. So we're not certain that this is a direct effect of GRSF1 function. So we thought, well, what else is in the granule? How are we going to look at that? So we IP'd GRSF1 over and over and over again and got kind of weird results. And then Hannah came up with the smart idea and said, well, if this is all in a granule and there's RNA metabolism going on there and maybe ribosome biogenesis, why don't we UV cross-link it? Maybe we'll bring down the whole factory that's in the granule. And that's exactly what happened. So when we did that and mass spec'd the IP, we found a whole toolbox of proteins, all of which are involved in RNA metabolism. So these two RNA helicases, which I'll show you in a minute, affect the biosynthesis of the large ribosomal subunit. A protein called FASTKD2, which I'll talk a fair amount about, the poly-A polymerase, two subunits of the RNase P, these two subunits of the so-called degradosome that degrades mitochondrial messenger RNAs, also in the granules. And I'll just jump here. These three proteins that are RNA methyltransferases that Dan Bogenhagen showed were in these granules, although he called them nucleoids, but they're clearly in the granules adjacent to the nucleoids. So there's a lot of RNA metabolism happening here. This is where most of the action is after the polycistronic transcripts are moved there. So what are these FASTKD proteins? Again, Alexis Jourdain in Jean-Claude Martinu's lab was working on these things at the same time we were, although he worked on FASTK and not the other ones. So the founding member of this family is called FASTK, and it was involved, and I won't go into the gory details, in apoptosis, just to make a long story short. So it shuttles, apparently, between mitochondria and the nucleus. The other five are all mitochondrial proteins. And they have this domain called fast-activated serine-threonine kinase based on what was known about FASTK, but there's absolutely zero evidence that these things have any kinase activity, like identically zero evidence if they have any kinase activity. They do have these domains. We don't know really what they mean. This domain this wrap domain at the end is a putative RNA binding domain, which is enriched in AP complexins. That's what the AP stands for on those guys. And they've been picked up, most of these things have been picked up in large scale screens for RNA binding proteins. So they look like bona fide RNA binding proteins, but nobody had really investigated them. Massimo Zeviani's group had found a point mutation in FASTKD2 associated with an encephalopathy, a little bit like Leigh syndrome, and that's a single case in the literature where there's a mutation associated with these proteins. So we decided to work on two of the helicases and another of the FASTKD proteins, FASTKD5, and so we did the usual stuff. We knocked them down. Hannah did this, and I'm not going to show you all of the details on it, but we found that if you did that with DHX30, one of these helicases, completely wiped out assembly of the respiratory chain. FASTKD2, you got defects and basically everything, but you didn't wipe everything out, not so much in complex 5. And if you knock down FASTKD5, you got a specific defect in complex 4. So the FASTKD proteins were producing different things, and the helicase was producing something a little bit different as well. So if you look at translation, this is all a translation problem. So if you look at DHX30, you basically can't translate when you get rid of DHX30. You translate a lot less with FASTKD2 knockdown. And what was really interesting, and this took us a while to figure out, was when we knocked down FASTKD5, we got a global defect in translation, but really specifically, cytochrome oxidase 1 was completely missing in the translation. We thought, that's kind of weird. How can we figure that out? And at the time, we were doing QRT-PCR and everything, which I hate. And I said, Hannah, please do some northern blots. Just do a northern blot. Like, show me the bands, make me a believer that this is, like, real, okay? Because this is just, like, numbers that come out of something, and CTs and shit like that. So I didn't like that. So eventually, we did the northern blots. And the very first one she did, and I'll just show you the results for the message from cytochrome oxidase 1, showed that basically there was no mature method. There was hardly any mature message for cytochrome oxidase 1. And the 5' end of it, which is a non-coding tRNA, was not processed. So the other two things that weren't processed very well were cytochrome B and the bicistronic message ATP68 and cytochrome oxidase 3. And all three of those messages are not flanked by coding by tRNA, so they can't be processed by RNAs P, RNAs Z, and nobody knew how they were processed before. So FASTKD5 is responsible for this, and if you do not process that, if you keep the 5' end of cytochrome oxidase 1, it's abundantly clear you cannot translate that. And I won't show you the data, but if you look at the ribosomes, there looks like there's ribosome decay when you knock down FASTKD5. So these things probably clog up the ribosomes, can't be translated for reasons we don't know, and the ribosomes just decay, probably by some no-go decay pathway or something like that. The other ones we looked at, the two helicases in FASTKD2, only DDX28 ran with the large ribosomal subunit on a sucrose gradient. DHX30 is everywhere, but it's known that there are cytosolic isoforms of this guy as well. And to make a long story short, and I'm not going to show you all the data in the interest of time, there was impaired assembly of the large ribosomal subunit when we knocked down any of those three genes. And I won't go through all of that. So what I want to do is just maybe focus on one, because I'm not going to go through all of the data on all of them. FASTKD2, which is, as I said, has been associated with the disease. Massimo suggested it was only a cytochrome oxidase or a complex 4 deficiency, but in our hands, it's a multiple respiratory chain deficiency. So it leads to a combined deficiency, and that's due to a uniform decrease in the translation of the mitochondrial encoded gene products. It leads to dysregulation of mitochondrial RNA levels that I haven't showed you, and specifically the 16S, or the ribosomal RNA that's associated with the large subunit, is reduced to 50% of controls. The levels of both the large subunit and consequently the monosome are decreased, but the small subunit is increased, perhaps in trying to compensate for that defect. We don't really know. We did some RNA-seq experiments and showed that FASTKD binds, FASTKD2 really selectively binds the 16S subunit of ribosomal DNA, as does, by the way, DDX28, which Tony Barrientos in Miami had also found. So these things are clearly somehow involved in the biosynthesis of the large ribosomal subunit by interacting with the RNA that's a component of the large ribosomal subunit. So how are we going to figure this out? about who's doing what. So I don't know how we eventually came across this bio-ID assay. I had read about it, and Heidi had been talking to Brian Rott, who's a partner of Anne-Claude Jing Gras, both of whom are expert mass spectroscopists, who were doing this so-called bio-ID assay. And let me explain what it is. It's basically a way of looking at who proteins are talking to in a cell. It's independent of the affinity of any kind of complex that you try to bring down with immunoprecipitation. It just tells you how often these guys see one another, and when they see one another, they tag them with biotin, and then you can analyze that. So what you do is you make a bio-ID fusion protein, which is your protein. You can tag it either N or C terminally. If you're going to target, do something in mitochondria, most often would tag it at the C terminus because you need the N terminal targeting sequence to get it there. Stick it in an HEK cell with a promoter that's inducible. You add a little bit of biotin, and you can do this for probably 6 hours even, but often we do it for 24 hours. So you express the protein from zero and express it to levels which are not so dissimilar from control levels in the cell. So you don't really want to blast everything and then get these overexpression artifacts that you often get from this kind of stuff. And then what it does, because the biotinylase that you put on there is promiscuous, it biotinylates any lysine that's solute accessible around, just finds them and biotinylates them. And then what you can do is capture those things, the proteins that were biotinylated on streptavidin beads. And because the biotin-streptavidin complex is like, you cannot break it, it's extraordinarily, has a high affinity constant. You can wash the bejesus out of these things, get rid of everything, and then you mass spec what's left. And when you mass spec what's left, and then presumably that's your kind of interactome. So you can build up interactomes of all these proteins and find out who is talking to whom there, and maybe figure out, at least generate a hypothesis about what these proteins might be doing. So we've now done this, and this is one of these like system biology things, interactomes you're not supposed to be able to read, right? I've never ever had a slide like this in my whole life. So Hannah's been playing with these things using hierarchical clustering algorithms, and this is just to show you that it kind of works. So we've done so far about 30 so-called prays. These are the things you biotinylate, and the baits are what gets biotinylated. And you can cluster them and see if something makes sense. So if this were working, what you'd expect to see is something like this. So you'll see clusters of things, which, and this is a heat map, by the way. So the red is a lot of biotinylation, and the blue is none. So you see strings here associated with particular genes that label a bunch of genes here that can, that also cluster, hopefully, into some kind of functional groups. And you see spots here that are completely blue. So it makes, it's what you expect. And I'm going to zoom in on one example of that in a second. But it's kind of early days in this. So we've only done, I think, 25 or so. And we're hoping to do like a few hundred if we get time and money to do that kind of thing. So you can validate this, which we did early on. You can actually do it sort of gene by gene if you know what you're looking for. So here's the FASTKD2 protein that we're interested in. It has a molecular weight of around 80 kilodaltons. And you can see if you, there's a flag tag on the biotin molecule as well. So if you use anti-flag, you can see that it gets expressed transiently, but not very much in the cell. So it's rather low. And because we brought it down with GRSF1 in this thing, we would expect to see GRSF1. Biotinylated. So if we use an anti-biotin antibody, what we see is a protein here that runs at the exact molecular weight of GRSF1. And what you see is probably nothing else either on this. So what this says is that's probably the main interacting partner, both by IP and by this bio-ID assay. But there might be something else there that you can't see on this blot just because we don't have the sensitivity. And that turns out to be true, which is the beauty of this whole thing. So what I show you here are some of the proteins that we brought down. We didn't bring them down. They were biotinylated and brought down in the streptavidin beads by this assay. And what you can see, and this is the number of spectra. These are duplicate experiments. So GRSF1 is by far the top prey gene that it brings down. And this is a number that reflects the blue or red color in the heat map. And this is the ratio of what we have seen, we being the royal we, so all of Anne-Claude's database, everything else she's ever done with bio-D. So this is like five times over represented there. But what caught our eye were these two proteins here, one called TRUB2 and one called mTurf-D1, which is also called mTurf3. The nomenclature is horrible for that kind of stuff. And what we saw was that there was like a huge ratio here. So this had basically never been seen almost in a bio-ID experiment. And this ratio was also pretty big relative to other things. There were a lot of ribosomal subunits that were kind of backgroundy here, all large, though. And then remember, FASTKD2 binds to the 16S, so that kind of made sense. But these are the guys that got that piqued our interest here. So what are they? What's TRUB2? It is a pseudouridine synthase. It's a homolog of one of them in E. coli. In humans, there's about 23 proteins that have PS-like domains, and there's about 8 or 9 pseudouridine synthases that have been characterized. And what do pseudouridine synthases do? They take uridine and they make pseudouridine. And of course, that modification has been known forever in tRNAs, and there's a lot of pseudouridines in tRNAs that are important for the stability and the structure of the tRNA molecule. And it's only recently been appreciated that pseudouridinylation is actually more common than we thought. And there were 3 papers that came out, one in Nature Methods, one in Cell, and one in Nature last year, showing that in yeast and in mammals, this conversion of uridine to pseudouridine happens not only in ribosomal RNAs, happens in messenger RNAs, happens in long non-coding RNAs as well. And it seems to be important for function, although nobody knows exactly what those functions are in the messages. So what's mTERF3? Well, Niels Larsen's lab has worked on this for quite a while. It's named for mitochondrial transcription termination factor domain containing 1, and it turns out that many of these mTERFs probably have not very much to do with transcription termination, so maybe we're going to have to rewrite the book on that. Niels knocked it out. Globally in the germline, it's embryonic lethal, like many other important mitochondrial genes. And when they did a heart-specific knockout, he suggested it was a negative regulator of mitochondrial transcription, because what he found was the steady-state level of a lot of mitochondrial transcripts went up. And then he later revisited that when he was doing some work in Drosophila and looked back at the mouse data and showed that it actually binds to the 16S ribosomal RNA, just like FASTKD2. And it's essential for assembly of the mitochondrial large subunit. So that's kind of cool. Here we brought down with BioID. And incidentally, when we did an IP, we also brought these 2 proteins down, you know, amongst a whole bunch of other things, though. So I think what we'd sort of do is a Venn diagram there and see what comes with both. And that gives us a fair amount of confidence that those things maybe are real. So it looks like they're both involved in assembly of large ribosomal subunit. So there's a way to look at this, and it's called pseudoseq. Or pseudouridinylation sequencing by RNA-seq analysis. And what you do is add a molecule, which I'll just abbreviate as CMC, because it's this long beast here, to the RNA, and it actually binds uridine, pseudouridine, and guanosine. And then you stick it in an alkali, and only pseudouridine survives. So if you're doing RNA-seq, it produces a strong stop. So you read along through the RT, and then all of a sudden you stop. And so when you get a whole bunch of stops there, you figure that's got to be pseudouridine at that particular position. You can also do it by primer extension, which is like the poor man's way to do it, but you have to know what you're looking for, because you have to know exactly what the base is that you think is pseudouridinylated. So Hanna did that. In the ribosomal RNA, in the 16S, there's only 1 reported pseudouridine at this position here, in this stem loop of the predicted secondary structure of this RNA. The mammalian mitochondrial ribosomal RNAs are not very much modified as compared to the large ribosomal RNAs in the cytosol, which are hugely modified with pseudouridines and methyl groups. There's some methylations in this, but that's the only pseudouridine that's known. So we don't really have the whole answer for this, unfortunately. So Hanna did actually a primer extension assay initially, knocked down FASTKD2, knocked down this TRUB2 protein, and knocked down mTERF1 as kind of controls, and there was no difference. And here, but the problem was we were only able to knock this down by about 80%. And we got 80% of the pseudouridine there that we got compared to the other ones. So we don't know yet if this is real or not real. So we're going to have to CRISPR this guy, just get rid of it, and then go back and do the same experiment. Except now we're going to do the RNA-seq and look in an unbiased way to see if there are any other pseudouridines in the molecule that might be important for its maturation and or function. So we knocked down all of these guys too, and I just want to make one interesting point here, is that if you knock down mTERF1, the stability, apparent stability, of both FASTKD2 and this TRUB2 molecule are decreased enormously. So it looks like these are somehow interdependent and maybe all involved in maturation of the ribosomal, the large ribosomal RNA in mitochondria, and assembly of the large ribosomal subunit. But that's just a hypothesis. So this is, I'll just show you one other little kind of snapshot of the mitochondrial ribosomal proteins and the clustering analysis. This is all like really preliminary stuff because we don't have a lot of data that we've put in this yet. But what you can see is that what clusters is M251. Here's C12ORF65 that we started out with. We didn't know what the function was at all. Here's TRUG2. This is FASTKD4. And TACO1 is a translational activator for cytochrome oxidase. But these guys, at least these ones here, all seem to make sense, especially M251, C12ORF65, and TRUG2. And what you can see with C12ORF65 is that it really lights up the entire mitochondrial ribosome, like it's way above background. So it clearly has something to do with the ribosome. We don't really know what. Something to do probably with the biosynthesis of the ribosome, because we haven't seen that with any other protein that we know interacts with the large ribosomal subunit. So I think that tells us that this is a pretty cool assay, at least to develop a hypothesis about what some of these proteins might be doing. And because it clusters with other things that also look like they're involved with the large ribosomal subunit, that gives us even more confidence in that suggestion. I'm going to finish with one thing. I think I'll be on time. It's another patient that we looked at. We tried to pick these patients judiciously because we didn't want to find a structural subunit of the respiratory chain. We wanted to find new biology. So we did the same kind of thing. We looked at blue native gels, looked for global defects, looked for translation defects, and then tried to figure out what the gene was. And so Alex Janet did this when he came to my lab as a postdoc. And by then, a whole exome sequencing was there, and a guy named Jacek Majewski at the Genome Center emailed me and said, how would you like all your mutations served to you on a platter instead of doing this the hard way? And I said, yes, please. Like, when can I have them? And so we got in kind of early on in the whole exome sequencing business and found a few things right away. And this was one of them. And the gene that's responsible for this disease, it was a very nasty disease. The child died in the first weeks of life. What's called RMND1, which tells you nothing, required for meiotic nuclear division 1. So this is from yeast. You need this to sporulate in yeast. You need the ortholog to sporulate in yeast. And we found a missense mutation in this coiled-coil domain. It's a membrane protein anchored in the inner mitochondrial membrane. And presumably, this is interacting with other proteins. And I won't show you all the data, but it probably forms a homopolymer. And it has, you know, these domains that we don't know about. Most of the things we find have duff domains in them. Nobody knows what they do because they're called domains of unknown function. So nobody knows what this protein did. It actually, if you looked at the biochemist, the molecular biology here, in the subject cells or the patient cells, all of the messages were kind of upregulated except for the large ribosomal, the 16S in the large ribosomal subunit. And if we looked at the steady state levels of some of the large subunits of the proteins of the large ribosomal subunit, they were down. This one called S2 is actually a large thing. And you can see that actually by the bio-ID. It's misnamed. And a couple of the other ones that are thought to be ribosomal subunits never get labeled, and so they're clearly just wrong. This thing forms a high molecular weight complex of about 240 kilodaltons. In the cells, the subject didn't have this thing, and you could restore it if you put back RMND1. And we showed through some experiments I don't have time to go into that this is probably a homopolymer. We think it's a homohexamer. And it's highly processed. It's about half, the monomer is about half its predicted molecular weight. And we've seen that by mass spec and by other means. We haven't quite mapped the exact N-terminus, but it's clearly highly processed by enzymes that we don't know about. Once we published that, we got a whole bunch of phone calls. This turns out to be not an uncommon rare disease, if I can say that. So some of them, there's like one family out there, and some of them, as soon as you publish it, a whole bunch of other ones pop up. And it turns out this is probably the most common phenotype for this. It's early lactic acidosis, renal failure, deafness, and multi-organ involvement. When I say multi-organ, I've never seen any other disease, mitochondrial disease like that, where really every single organ system is involved at some level or another. Some more severe than others, but it's just like this long laundry list of everything. So like muscle, kidney, liver, the whole nine yards. And this patient didn't have a very severe defect in fibroblasts, but had no protein that we could see. So the other one was a missense mutation. This was null for the protein. Also didn't produce, this is now a skeletal muscle sample. Whoops, get back. and also didn't produce this large molecular weight complex, and had a very severe decrease in the respiratory chain in skeletal muscle, but I don't show you the fibroblasts, but not so much. And now these are the last few slides. So we wondered what this thing was doing. We knew it was important with translation, probably in the stability of the mitochondrial ribosome. And so we eventually got a pretty good antibody. We made one of our own and bought five others. And ours worked, and one of the others that we bought also worked. And when we labeled it in cells, these are human primary fibroblasts, you can see that it's also punctate in the cells. And it looks a little bit like either the nucleoids or the RNA granules. And in the patient where we had no protein, we didn't see any of those punctates. So that was comforting to know that the antibody actually worked on IF. We'd also knocked it down and shown that before as well. And what it really, it doesn't align with the nucleoids, but what it does is it's juxtaposed with newly synthesized RNA. So this is BRU labeling again. So this is newly very short pulse of BRU, so polycystronic transcripts that are immediately transferred to the RNA granule. And what we see in most of these cases is that RMND1 looks like these Mickey Mouse ears on the face of the RNA granule. And we know it's anchored to the inner mitochondrial membrane, forming this large molecular weight complex. So we don't know exactly what it's doing, but if you get rid of it, you destabilize the ribosome. Ribosomes are made here, so perhaps there's some kind of transfer of ribosomes to this complex, which now tethers it to the inner membrane, stabilizes it, does something. We're investigating that, and we don't really know what happens. So I have 59 seconds left. I'll just conclude. What I think I've shown you by studying human disease, we're able to get at things which we wouldn't necessarily have predicted. We wouldn't have found them out of blue sky. And I think we tried to choose the diseases carefully, or at least choose the biochemistry carefully, so that we'd come across something that was interesting biologically that was unknown. And I think we're reasonably successful in doing that. And what I've shown you today, I think, is that these granule structures, these suborganellar structures, are really key factories, are central hubs for processing and handling the transcripts, and they're also central hubs for assembling the mitochondrial ribosome, kind of analogous to the nucleolus, although it's just an analog. It obviously doesn't have any homologous structures to what happens in the nucleolus where the cytosolic ones are assembled. The FASTKD proteins, and we're working on the whole family of these things now, we think that they might be adapters to recruit processing or modifying enzymes because we don't have any evidence that they themselves have, for instance, endonuclease activity that might allow processing. We don't know that for a fact. We'd have to purify the enzyme and look at the substrate. In the case of FASTKD5, we know that it can't, when we knock it down, the transcripts that do not have tRNAs cannot be processed, so there must be some other enzyme or an activity in FASTKD5 itself. For FASTKD2, we think it's modifying the ribosomal RNA, and perhaps this TRUB2 molecule is actually doing that pseudouridine inhalation, and that's necessary for maturation of the RNA. And finally, this, and I'm not sure this is the only one, but we came across this protein RMND1 that forms this membrane-bound complex that somehow spatially couples what's happening in the RNA granule to the eventual, to transfer of ribosomes to the inner mitochondrial membrane where they're thought to be tethered, or stabilizing that, we don't really know. But that's necessary for efficient translation. So I just want to thank the people who've done the work. This is some of my lab, except for one person who's in Thailand at the moment. And Hannah Antonishka is the person who's basically done everything with the RNA granules, and she should really be giving this talk. And Alexandre Janet, who's a research associate, was a postdoc in my lab, and is now a research associate, did all the work with RMND1. And Anne-Claude Gingras is this like amazing woman at University of Toronto who's doing the bio-ID stuff, and we have this very, very fruitful collaboration with her. And we've had collaborations around the world with lots of clinicians who've provided patients in the past. So thank you very much, and I'll be happy to take questions. If there are any.
So Eric, out of the, so there the three other termination factors.
Yep.
Do they also interact with GSRF1, or they have their own factors they interact with?
We didn't bring them down in the immunoprecipitate with that, and we don't identify them in the GRSF1 bioID either. The one that's called ICT1 has a homologan bacteria that's important for recycling stalled ribosomes. So that may be its function in human mitochondria as well. So these guys might have hung around to deal with ribosomes that somehow are not producing protein or get stalled in some way. We don't really know. We thought that C12R65 might be that too, except, you know, when you knock it down acutely, you get this huge translation defect, which kind of suggests it's part of the normal biosynthetic pathway or biogenesis pathway for ribosomes, because you wouldn't expect to have so many stalled ribosomes in, you know, like 24 hours. That's my guess, but I don't know. But we haven't picked the other ones up at all. The other thing that, interestingly, we haven't picked up with GRSF1 is the SLRP LRPPRC complex, which determines the stability of mitochondrial messages. And we don't know quite how that fits into this whole picture. That's the cause of the French-Canadian form of Leigh syndrome. And it does not localize to granules per se. It's not excluded from them, but it doesn't specifically localize in puncta and mitochondria. And so somehow it is interacting with messages, but we don't know at what stage at all.
So, yeah. Eric, you showed that GRSF1 bind to 3 light-stranded RNA, but GRSF1 knockdown induced small subunit shift to the bottom of gradient. Does this have some specificity?
In the sucrose gradient, you mean?
Translation.
In the sucrose gradient, you mean?
Yeah.
It doesn't migrate with the ribosome at all. So it's presumably interacting with, we don't know where it's interacting with these messages, but exactly in the ribosome, but presumably in the free pool of them. And it interacts with these two long non-coding RNAs about which we know essentially nothing. We've actually built some, this familial RNA binding protein we've engineered to bind these long non-coding ones and take them out of commission to see if we can get the same kind of, see if we can phenocopy the GRSF1 knockdown. But it doesn't migrate with the ribosome, and it's not on the monosome for sure. So when the messages end up being translated, or when the long non-coding RNAs are associated with the monosome doing we don't know what, it's probably not bound to GRSF1. At least we can't detect it on the sucrose gradient.
Is GRSF1 involved in RNA stability?
I don't understand. Is it RNA specific? Stability.
Turnover.
Ah.
RNA turnover.
I don't know the answer to that, actually. You mean did we look at the stability of the long non-coatings or ND6 in its absence? Yeah. So the ND6 message is destabilized. The long non-coding ones, I don't know.
Thank you.
Eric, very general question. I mean, there's this idea around since a long time now that there are specialized ribosomes that synthesize specialized subunits. Is there any evidence, if you look now at all your bioID assays or something, that this sorting somehow can occur already at the level of the RNA?
That's a really good question. And the short answer is no. There isn't yet. I mean, I'm not sure what you would see with that. So if you look, for instance, for chaperones that were involved in assembly, like Martin Ott has done, for instance, with cytochrome B, you know, in the yeast assay where he's looked for the downstream chaperones and found they were associated with subsets of ribosomes, I guess that's what you'd kind of be looking for. Is that the idea?
Exactly.
Yeah, we haven't done this yet. We've only done about 25 of the proteins that of the couple of hundred we're probably interested in this kind of assay, because it's a little bit labor intensive. It's not a very high throughput assay. And you really have to be sure you've got the right targeting and et cetera, for that thing. But that's something that might come out of it. Yeah. Jody.
So this RMND protein, have you started to look at the interdependence of RNA granules? So are there residual RNA granules left when you deplete this? And if they are they mislocalized? And conversely, what do you see like in a row zero cell with RMND1? Is it still focal? So are you getting at, you know, how these are spatially regulated?
I don't know that we've done it in a row zero cell. actually the granules sort of disappear in the row zero cells, but I'm not sure whether RMND1 does. I think Alex did a Western blot, but not an immunofluorescence experiment, so I can't answer whether that's still localized to the membrane. But I don't think you lose the granules if you lose RMND1. I think they're in, sorry, are they mis? I don't know. I haven't looked.
Hi, Martin from the Buck Institute in California. I have a very naive question, probably. If you're messing up the ribosomal biogenesis, do you end up with lower mitochondrial content? Have you looked at that at all?
Lower, you mean just mitochondrial volume?
Do they
volume?
Just have fewer, yeah, lower mitochondrial volume?
No, not really.
Because the old paper you were showing, it seemed not like a drastic effect at least, right?
Yeah, there really isn't any effect. I mean, if we look at all the disease cells we've looked at, there aren't that many morphology defects. Some of them have morphology defects, but the volume, and I must say almost everything we've done is in fibroblasts, a few are in myoblasts, so it could be vast, you know, really different in tissues. But in fibroblast cells, human primary fibroblasts, there are remarkably few differences in response to any of these manipulations. They kind of look very similar morphologically, with some exceptions, and the volume fraction of mitochondria is not so different.
Is that strange?
Is it strange?
Not really making a lot of proteins in the mitochondria, right?
I guess. Well, the problem is, you know, we've got skin fibroblast cells, which are not the most active cells in the body, growing in a lot of glucose, an infinite buffer, and so we're not really asking them to do very much.
Right.
So maybe if we play around, I mean, I must say we have played around with depriving them of glucose, of doing all kinds of stuff, and we don't see a lot. I mean, sometimes when we get a cell line and we know this thing is crucial, like this RMND1 protein in the first patient we looked at, we had a really severe phenotype in fibroblasts. And something we still don't understand is in the second patient, we had a really mild phenotype, but no protein. So we thought maybe it's a dominant negative. We tested that. It's not a dominant negative with the first mutation. So we don't know, like, what's going on with some of this stuff. And we tried, when we do that, we try to stress the cells, say, grow them in galactose, so deprive them of glucose, force them to use only mitochondrial function to produce ATP, and see if we can tease out something. And we didn't in that situation. And that's generally what we find. If there's no phenotype, there's no phenotype, and so far we haven't found a condition where we can elicit one in skin fibroblasts. So we need to use different cells. I mean, so need to use something like iPS cells, convert them into neurons or something like Anu was talking about yesterday. Use appropriate cells that are appropriate to the disease we're looking at and really study those. That's a lot more heroic than growing skin fibroblasts.
All right, thank you.
Yeah.
I think I have the last question. So RMND1, it's a meiosis-specific factor in yeast. So has anyone looked at these granules during regular meiosis to see, I mean, why is it required there?
Regular meiosis, you mean in the germline?
Yeah.
No. We haven't done, you mean in humans?
In humans would be one, or even just going back to yeast and looking at these granules. Why is it required
there? I don't know
that
yeast have the granules. Yeah, that's what you need. So, I mean, we were doing this thing with Charlie Boone once, you know, the synthetic lethal stuff with all these mitochondrial things. And the problem with all of them was you need to sporulate to do that assay. And if you don't have respiratory chain function, you can't sporulate. Right. So that's why this is called required for meiotic nuclear division. You need it for spores. And what it's exactly doing in yeast, I don't know that anybody's knows. But I'm not sure that anybody's looked for these kind of structures in yeast. Jody, you know? I don't know. Okay.
All right. Any other questions for Eric?
So they actually use the BRDU for the labeling the new synthesized RNA, am I correct?
BRU,
Yeah, so if that is the case, if your BRDU assay can contain the mitochondrial DNA,
so you can use BRDU to label the nucleoid to label the DNA, or BRU to label the RNA.
I mean, you are labeling where the mitochondrial RNA was synthesized.
Yeah.
So if that's the case, the mitochondrial DNA also required in that place. So if that's the case, can I assume the BRDU staining, BRU staining can contain the mitochondrial DNA?
It could, yes. No, that's why about 20% of the things that we see that are BRU positive do line up with the nucleoid. Because you have to make the RNA from the DNA in the nucleoid, so you'd expect to see some there, but it's really, really a minority. So we do a very short pulse, and what we see is that 80% of it at least co-localizes with the RNA granules. So what we presume is that what we're seeing on the nucleoid are things that we've just caught that are synthesizing the RNA. It's a small proportion, and as soon as it's transcribed, it's immediately somehow, we don't know how, transferred to this RNA granule structure.
Thank you.
All right, I think we can let Eric off the hook now and thank him for a great talk.